All right. Well, good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Thank you so much for braving the weather and the parking and coming on out to see our unsung heroes. It definitely will be worth your while, okay? I want to introduce myself. I am the branch manager of the Bayview Watton branch. Some of you might recognize me. My name is Linda Brooks Burton, and we've put this program on for 14 years now. So this is the 14th annual Unsung Hero Award. Yeah, go ahead. Every year, the library likes to take the time to honor those individuals who make it a priority to help make life better for others in the African American community. You're in for a special treat as we honor 9 people who go that extra mile to do just that. For the first time, we will be honoring someone in our library community who also exemplifies the attributes of a hero. So sit back and get ready to be truly inspired. To begin our program, we would like you to lend your ear to a young man who will be singing the first 2 verses of the Negro National Anthem. After he has sung those verses, we would like you, the audience, to stand and sing the first verse again. Jonathan Smothers is a young man, 17 years old, who attends Skyline High School. He's an actor, singer, has worked with the African American Shakespeare Company, the Belasco Theater, and Skyline Performing Arts. Please, let's give him a hand.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmony of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening stars. Let it resound loud as the rolling seas. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won.
Jonathan Smothers, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Stewart Shaw. I'm the African American Central Librarian here at the Main Library, and I'm the welcome to the 14th annual Unsung Heroes program. Thanks for coming out, for braving the rain, the traffic. Today's planned to be a great program. I'm going to introduce now our mistress of ceremony for the today's afternoon program. This will be her 4th time doing the honors for our program. She's a talented woman who has various experiences in her life, including living in Japan, doing stand-up comedy, and being a motivational speaker. She is also a patron and advocate of the San Francisco Public Library. When she first started with us, she had been a mother of one son for 11 years. She is now the mother of three, including a toddler daughter and a baby son. Please welcome Veronica Dangerfield.
Hello there, cousins. How y'all doing today? You know how blessed I am just to get out of the house? Woo! You know, I was successfully Miss Fertility in 2001 and 2000. But I'm giving it up, y'all. No more babies in this corner. But I would like to take the time today to thank a young man who washed some dishes this morning and who cleaned out after two small children so his mama could comb her hair. Thank you so much, my son Trent. Cousins, it is a wonderful day today. Y'all strangely say ashe. You know what? This is a family reunion. We're coming here to lift each other up. So if you haven't seen your cousin to the left or to the right, take your time and say hello. Say good afternoon. There's a wonderful things happening. All right. Okay, now we're here to lift up the community, and you know black folks ain't shy and they ain't quiet. Because I don't want now one of you. Can I have a big, strong, resounding ashe?
Ashe!
Woo! Ronnie likes that. Today we're honoring Langston Hughes. And I just wanted to give you just a few words from him before we start honoring our honorees. To fling my arms wide in some place of the sun, to twirl and to dance till the white day is done. When rest that cool evening beneath a tall tree, while a night comes on gently, dark like me, this is my dream. To fling my arms wide in the face of the sun, to dance, swirl, swirl, till the quick day is done. Reset at pale evening, a tall, slim tree, night coming on gently, black like me. Y'all say that, black like me. All right, and now we have our first honoree, a Miss Dorothy Scott, a truly beautiful, go on, Ashe, put your hands together. Miss Scott uses her talents by volunteering in the church, the school, and in her work environment. Edna Coleman, a past recipient of the Unsung Hero Awards, nominated Miss Scott and describes her as an organizer and a leader in the community. On all of that, she's resplendent too. Don't she look beautiful? Woo-hoo, Miss Scott! As a 20-year member of the New Strangers Home Baptist Church, Ms. Scott has served as an usher, a youth advisor, and a program chair. She's a trustee and chair of the financial board. Ms. Scott is a great cook. May I please have your telephone number and your address? I'll see you at Thanksgiving morn. She works with seniors, and she's running errands, and she's dropping off medications, and she's helping bringing food and helping them dress. Put your hands together for supporting the seniors in the community. God bless you, Miss Scott. If it ain't obvious by now, Miss Scott owns her own hat business. And she's been a cosmetician at Walgreens for 30 years. Miss Scott, how do you do anything for 30 years? Oh, I heard that. As a recent widow, Miss Scott is the mother of three sons and a grandmother of four. She says her reward is in the giving that she's compelled to do day by day. Well, today, Miss Scott, we are honored and we are privileged to give the Unsung Hero Award to you today. Please come up and accept.
The award reads, San Francisco Public Library Appreciation Unsung Hero, Dorothy Scott.
Thank you. There you go. Thank you. Let me just say one other word.
I also wanted to mention that Sophie Maxwell sent 9 proclamations for all of our awardees today. So she also has a proclamation from Sophie Maxwell's office. Congratulations.
Good afternoon. To Lender, the library, to Ms. Coleman for the nomination, to the selection board, selection committee for your selection of me, and to God be the glory. My phone rings and I'm constantly traveling and everybody says you do so much, but you know, it's really nothing because you do what has to be done at the time that it has to be done. And that's what life is all about. If you can't give to others and share with your fellow man, lend a helping hand, then your life is not worth living. Because as the Bible says that we must love one another. And unless we love one another, we cannot love God. And God is not gonna come here and give us things to do that he's given us hands to do it with. So we have to take the talent that God has given us, the kindness, the goodness in our hearts to serve our fellow man. And again, thank you very, very much. This is just such a shock to me. I'm still in awe and I'm never lost for words, but I think right now, I think I kind of am. But thank you so, so very much. My sons are out of state and they are just praying and with me as I accept this award. Thank you very, very much.
She's receiving flowers over here. She looked just like Miss America now, huh? Do the wave. Go ahead, do the wave. All right. Ashe, Ashe. When you serve God through God's compassion, you empower yourself with greater strength. You elevate your mind with higher thoughts. You soar with the angels. This is called complete service. Now we're talking about Miss Verlie Pickens. She was born in Lake Charles, Louisiana, and she moved to San Francisco 63 years ago. She's the mother of one, grandmother of two, and great-grandmother of one, and she's a devoted member of Jones Methodist Church, and she enjoys theater. She has lived in Bayview for over 50 years, and she devoted most of her time to the community. Ashe, ashe, Ms. Pickens. Ms. Pickens is a woman of sustenance who should be recognized for all of the good deeds that she does in assisting seniors in the community. And that's exactly what we plan to do. We're gonna lift you up, Ms. Pickens, because it's about time. Ain't that right, cousins? Put your hands together. All right, then that's fine. Oh, no, it's all right. I have tripped over these stairs before, hon. Just take your time.
Good afternoon to each and everyone and to my fellow Americans. I was born in Louisiana and came out here in 49. And I came out volunteering to take care of my sister-in-law. That's how I came out. Amen. And I've been volunteering ever since. I volunteered even at my hometown when I was a girl. All the neighbors wanted Verlie to go to the store for them because they trusted me. And I'm still being trusted, I think.
Amen. Amen.
But I do love everyone I meet. It's not a person I've never met that I didn't love and enjoying being a member and a friend. So please, I appreciate those who volunteered and signed me in. I don't know who put me in to be a hero, unsung hero, but I love everyone. And anytime if you think you need me, no, not too much, but I would love to come and do whatever I can for you. Thank you so very much.
Not only does she come and accept the award, but she asks to give service again. Is that awesome, cousins? Put your hands together. Our next recipient is Joanne Tiger, and unfortunately she can't be here today, but she is going to be represented by some of the youth that she has the opportunity to work with. She's the owner of a daycare and a praise dance instructor. And when our children are praising and dancing for the Lord, they're not doing anything else, are they? Put your hands together for praise dancing, cousins. All right, y'all, don't make me the only one excited up here. Okay, she teaches and supports the efforts of the youth and has opened her heart and she's opened her home to any of those who needs assistance. The girls she teaches at Praise Dance have learned to be poised and professional, and they carry this skill with them wherever they go for a lifetime. Miss Tiger couldn't be here today because of a prior engagement out of state, but here to honor her are three of the praise dancers she's instructed. Please welcome the New Vision Praise Dancers, who will also accept the award on her behalf. Put your hands together. The youth are coming to dance. What amazing young women. One more time. And the next nominee, we are so honored. We are so honored to have Willa Sims here. Y'all put your hands together, Ms. Sims. Ms. Sims, just, you know what? There's no way you can give out too much love today. So if you got an allowance, just go ahead and give it out. We'll replenish it, don't worry. Ms. Sims was nominated by her daughter. She's a dedicated mother of six. Woo, six children, woo. Well, three, I know how hard that is. She's a grandmother of seven and a great-grandmother of one. She was a juvenile probation officer for 28 years. Yeah. She also found the time to volunteer in her community in Bayview Hunters Point. She's originally from Chi-Town. All right. She lived in Bayview for over 50 years, and she's had a positive impact on not one generation, not two, but several generations of San Francisco youth. I said several generations, cousins. Even today, she is stopped by and greeted by adults whose lives she's influenced as teens by her compassionate care. As a young woman, Ms. Sims toured with the opera Mikado under the direction of Richard Rogers. As a dedicated patron and participant of the performing arts, Ms. Sims has enjoyed performing as part of the Sweet Adeline's Women Chorus. She also is a tutor of her own Project Read. Not somebody else's, but her own Project Read. Ms. Sims, when you get up here, you're gonna have to sing I'm Every Woman, okay? She's cheerful, she's sweet, she doesn't want to be in the limelight, but today we get the blessed opportunity to let her light shine as strong as we can. So Ms. Sims, don't be shy. Please come on up and let us honor you. Woo-hoo!
Beautiful rendition has just got my heart pounding. I love that kind of entertainment, of course. But I want to thank the Lord for his many blessings from day to day. That's about the first thing I ever do whenever I'm going to do something important, or even if it isn't important. I thank the Lord. I want to thank the Lord from day to day. And I want to thank each one of you for being here and helping us try to do what we can for each other and for ourselves. And I would like to start out by saying that the way I got started was in the nursery school in the Bayview district. But before all of that, the Bayview was really started out by Ms. Doris Ward, who got a committee together to help other people learn how to do what they can for the community. Not for themselves, but for the community, and that means all of us. And so she got this committee together, and they worked very diligently to try to get the different areas together to find out what we should do for ourselves and to string along. And many of them, one of the programs was 900 families learn how to take care of their business, their finances, learn how to buy a house, and a lot of them have gone to Antioch, blah, 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 and all those other places, you know, after they took the course. Well, that means that, you know, do what you can. Just do what you can. Somebody will pick it up. Somebody will be helped. It doesn't mean that you have to have a very large group of people, but whatever you do, if it's from your heart and you pray that all things would be possible with God, as we all know. And that's one of the main things that I have been doing all my life is prayer. I believe so very strongly, it's so beautiful. If you should just pray, you don't have to even be on your knees. Because I've prayed many times at the bus stop going to work. Nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened. I got to my destination on time every day for all those years you heard the lady say. And I thank the Lord for that. It's not my doing. It's not anyone's doing but God. God is our refuge. God is our help at every need. God is my ever hunger feed. God walks beside us, guides our way through every moment of the day. I now am wise, I now am true, patient, kind, and loving too. All things I am can do and be since Christ the Lord that is in me. Lord, I cannot be sick, I'm failing quick. God is my all, I know no fear, since God and love and truth are here. Now, here's a few things that have happened in our neighborhood that's been very helpful. And I want you to just bear with me as a fire chief sat to listen to some of the things that the paper tells us to do, to use diversity in helping each other, and no matter who they may be, try to get along with them. And so this, I write speeches, and you can give me an invitation, I'll come. That's what happens. If you give me an invitation, I come, see? And I went to the YMCA breakfast the other day, and I sent all my children to the school that they're taking it over, the All Hallows School. A lot of people don't know that. There's a big sign up there, YMCA. And it's been very hurting to many of us. And I didn't make a speech, they asked me, but I did. I wanted to tell them that I used to sell ice cream on the second floor. Had nothing to do with what they were doing. But it was in my heart. You know, I had come to the building where I had spent many years on all the floors doing this or that, or even cleaning up where the other class did not clean up, and such as that. And our YLI met there, and it was kind of tearful. But, you know, we have to do that. I got a lovely letter from the YMCA saying your presence was all so wonderful that we were glad that you came. So that made me feel good, didn't it? You send me an invitation, I'll come. You know? And so this is something that I wrote for the shipyard notes, important facts and people in the community of Bayview Hunters Point. And we've been practicing diversity for many years. For many years, we help each other. We watch each other's children while someone goes to the beauty shop or shopping. No questions asked, so that we can get things done. We've been doing that. But now, today, as you read the paper, they say, practice diversity, because we have people from other countries that we have to learn their culture and to try to get along and make things work. We participate in sharing and giving and caring about one another in the surrounding church, regardless of their ethnic background. We give food, rotating to churches. The Opera House practices teaching art to children. and the teenagers interview senior citizens concerning their background. All this has been going on. Nobody knows it except those that came, just like no one will probably know it except all you beautiful soldiers of the cross that came today. Network for Elders, you know, gave a volunteer club, a gala award, a dinner at the Burlingame Hotel. Of course, I didn't mean to put that in there. My granddaughter put this on the computer, but that, but it says Willa L. Sims, one of the group of volunteer winners. We have the ballet teacher, Century 21 School, a teacher of gifted middle high school students, a tutor for grade school. We have UC graduates in our neighborhood, and the grocery store for years by UC graduates. She's still standing there. And we have an attorney who was a former police officer, lived next door to me. We were so glad to see her. She was a police officer, and she was so cute in her uniform. And we were peeking out the window at her when she come home for lunch and everything. And we were so proud of her. That was when they were first having women in the police department. And then, but now, they gave her an assignment that didn't coincide with her family, and now she's an attorney. Now, isn't that good? Oh, yes, sirree. And so we want to think that, you know, the environment around is very important. And if you can pat somebody on the back for what they do, and we used to hug her and tell her how cute she was and all that, and tell people, you know, don't hold back, you know. Say, that's nice. And if you see teenagers, try to help them, try to teach people to tie their shoes for little children, or to count to 100, or to learn their ABCs. All these tall guys around, you know, at the, you know, they can do that. And it means a lot to both sides, to them and to the child and to the family of those children. We have to get out there and do that on our own without any questions asked, as I would say. There are many people to speak after me, but we have the NAACP president for years, as you know, our college over there. And we have the business office affairs. We have the 42 units at All Hallows there, run by Sister Grace, who was raised in the neighborhood. That's good. She was raised in the neighborhood as a child. And now she's running all those people that live at those residences there. And we have two sisters that took care of their mother. They bought every ticket that I sold. Oh, excuse me.
It ain't that we don't love you, because we love you so much. Put your hands together,
Louise. Oh, is this too much? Thanks.
It's all right, hon. I get it, sweetie.
All right. Thank you for listening.
I think I'm gonna take her home with me. She's so cute. Miss Sims says that if you had something in your heart, there was something good that you had in your heart, she said to share it with somebody. So I want all of you to make it your responsibility today to do something good, to say something good to somebody, to lift them up. All righty here. And now we have a treat. Bear with me while I try to say the name. The Adigun, Sipho, Angola-Capoeira Dance and Drum Troupe. Now I deserve an applause just for getting that out, you guys. So this is gonna be a rare treat. They're wonderful to watch. Right after that, we're gonna have a 10-minute 10-minute, just a little 10-minute break, and then we're going to finish our fabulous program. You guys are great. Give yourselves a hand. You've done wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
Good afternoon. First, we're going to show you some authentic Congolese dance from the Congo. Then we'll show you the rites of passage dance, which is the Capoeira de Angola. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, now we're going to show you the rites of passage dance the young men are going to do. And we had other members of the troop, but, you know, they've gotten stuck, I know, in the parade, because I know it's very hard for them to get across, because it was very hard for us to get across and find some place to park and then haul all our equipment up. That was quite tedious. We dedicate this performance to all of the young men that we're losing in our Bayview community. And, you know, if our community doesn't address this issue, and I mean, I'm not saying, you know, get out on the street and necessarily march about it, but if we don't start expressing more love and concern for our young men and make them visible in our community, you know, then they won't, you know, they won't feel that they have to group up with a group and carry a gun so that they'll so-called get what they call respect. And it's up to all of us to do that. You know, we need to just focus more on them. And when we see these young men, it's nothing wrong with saying, hello, young man, how are you? When we see some of them that play baseball, you know, like when I was young and we played baseball, somebody would say, hey, young man, what position do you play at? What's the team and what's your batting average? We don't give to give them that kind of visibility. So naturally, they want to be seen, they want to be heard, so they're going to do something negative. And so now we fear them. And we shouldn't fear the children that are ours, that we gave birth to them. So when you see these young men out here trying to stand up, trying to be responsible, wearing their pants correctly, which right now, that's a bold statement to wear your pants correctly, because you're showing other ones that I can stand up and try to be a civilized human being. And, you know, a lot of them are persecuted for that. But if we don't address it, if we don't say, that's right, young man, you know, you're a fine-looking young man there, well, then they're going to fall to the same negativity like everybody else. Okay, thank you.
Started in the Congo, because it's not told as it is. The Congolese rite of passage dance called Ungulu. Ungulu in Ketuba means strong. It's called the dance of the strong. It was taken from a ritual dance that the zebras do during mating season. And they zebras do a little fighting kind of mock dance. So the Congolese Bantu people took this dance and made a form out of it for young men to do to pass their rites of passage. And then they were allowed to take on a wife, and they were allowed to have status in the village or the community. And that way they could produce decent men who then would marry decent women who passed their rites of passage, and then you would have a more fertile village and a more fertile community. Thank you.
Everything is not dead in the Bayview district. There are some people trying to live decently. So I hope this is a ray of light.
Cousins, I can't hear you out there, cousins. I'd like to ask you a favor. Do y'all remember that song? Rolling, 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 keep them doggies rolling. Well, we gonna keep the program rolling. Because we have other treats in store for you, and God bless you for getting out in the storms and coming here to the San Francisco Public Library, because there ain't a better place to be in town. Ashe! And now you guys have a treat in store. Oh my goodness. This man, his name is Peter Temple. He's a graduate of the drama studio of London. London. Mr. Temple is an instructional assistant as well as a resident scenic artist at the Contra Costa College. He's performed at the Oregon Shakespeare Festival in Ashland, the Berkeley Shakespeare Festival, the Napa, and the African American Shakespeare Festival. He has been all around the world, but all the places that he could be, guess where he is today? With all my cousins at the San Francisco Public Library. So give them a warm welcome, please.
Good afternoon. As you've heard, my name is Peter Temple. I was asked to do three poems for you this afternoon by Langston Hughes. The first will be A Dream Deferred. What happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun, or fester like a sore and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat, or does it crust in sugar ore like a syrupy sweet? Maybe it just sags like a heavy load, or does it explode? The next is Let America Be America Again. Let America be America again. Let it be the dream it used to be. Let it be the pioneer on the plain seeking a home where he himself is free. For America was never America to me. Let America be the dream the dreamers dreamed. Let it be the great, strong land of love, where kings never contrived nor tyrants schemed that any man be crushed by one above. It never was America to me. Let my land be the land where liberty is crowned with no false patriotic wreath, but opportunity is real and life is free. Equality is in the air we breathe. There's never been equality for me, nor freedom in this land of the home of the free. Say, who are you that mumbles in the dark? And who are you that draws the veil across the stars? I am the poor white, fooled and pushed apart. I am the Negro, bearing slavery's scars. I am the red man driven from the land. I am the immigrant clutching the hope I seek and finding only the same old stupid plan of dog eat dog, of mighty crushing the weak. I am the young man full of hope and strength, tangled in the ancient endless chain of profit, power, gain, of grab the land, grab the gold, grab the way of satisfying need. Of the workmen, of take the pay, of owning everything for one's own greed. I am the farmer, bondsman to the soil. I am the worker sold to the machine, I am the Negro, servant to you all. I am the people, humble, hungry, mean. Hungry, yet today, despite the dream, beaten, yet today. Oh, pioneers, I am the man who never got ahead. I am the poorest worker battered through the years, yet I am the one who dreamed the basic dream in the old world where still serfs served kings, who dreamed a dream so strong, so brave, so true that even yet its mighty daring sings in every brick and stone, every furrow turned that has made America the land it has become. I am the man who sailed those early seas in search of what I meant to be my home. I am the one who left dark Ireland's shores and Poland's plain and England's grassy lea, and torn from Africa's stand, I came to build the home of the free. Free. Who said free? Not me. Surely not me. The millions on relief today, the millions shot down when we strike, the millions who have nothing for our pay, for all the dreams we've dreamed, for all the songs we've sung, for all the hopes we've held, for all the flags we've hung, and millions who have nothing for our pay except the dream that is almost dead. Today. Let America be America again. The land that has never been yet, and yet must be. The land where every man is free. The land that's mine. The poor man's, the Indians, me, who made America. Whose sweat and blood, whose faith and pain, whose hands at the foundry, who's plowed in the rain. We must bring back that mighty dream again. Sure, you call me any ugly name you choose. The steel of freedom does not stain from whose hands like leeches on people's lives. We must take back our land again. America. Yes, I say it plain. America was never America to me. And yet I swear this oath. America will be. Out of the rack and ruin of the gangster's death, out of rape and rot and graft and stealth and lies, we the people must redeem the land, the mines, the plains, the rivers, the mountains, the endless plains, all that stretch over this great green land, and make America again. The Negro speaks of rivers. I've known rivers. I've known rivers ancient as the world and older than the flow of human blood in humans' veins. My soul has grown deep like the rivers. I bathed in the Euphrates when dawns were young. I built my hut near the Congo, and it lulled me to sleep. I looked upon the Nile and raised the pyramids above it. I heard the singing of the Mississippi when Abe Lincoln went down to New Orleans, and I've seen its muddy bosom turn all golden in sunset. I've known rivers, ancient, dusky rivers, and my soul has grown deep like the river. Thank you.
Wow. I wish I had that voice when I was screaming at my children. Pick up that trash! You know what? I got a treat for you cousins, because you guys have been so wonderful to sit here and participate in the program. I cooked for you. We have a nice, big, fat, luscious buffet as soon as the program's over. So if you stay, you can eat. How about that? Can I hear an ashe in the house? Because I tell you, it's the National Negro Women give it, and they be some cakes that make you want to faint. They're wonderful. So stick around. And now we have a very, very special guest here. We have the Poet Laureate. That means she's the queen of poems in all of San Francisco, but it might be the world, because she's just that good. Can I hear an ashe, cousins? Y'all ain't falling asleep on me now, are you? All right. Devorah Major became the third Poet Laureate in San Francisco in April of 2002. Y'all can applaud for that. Thank you. She won the Penn Oakland Josephine Miles Award for Literary Excellence for Street Smarts and the Black Caucus of the American Libraries Association First Novel Award for An Open Weave. She has a second novel published. A second novel published. You go, girl. When I grow up, I'm gonna write a book. Her poems, her short stories, and her essays are available in a number of magazines and anthologies. She's taught poetry and creative writing as a community artist in residence and our college adjunct professor for over 20 years. She is currently working on a speculative fiction novel entitled Eye Shadows. Put your hands together for Devorah Majors.
So nice to see you all in the rain. We be all that we be and nothing less. We be all that we have done and much, 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 much more. We be the cause and the effect. We be the sharp and the blunted. We be the dig deep, climb high, shift shallow, and fall and fall and fall and fall. We be the stay down and the get back up. We be the ready to run and the willing to fight. We be the always forgetting and the ever remembering. We be the many, even when we are the few. We be the living, even when we are the dying. We be all that we be and nothing less. We be all that we be and nothing less. Thank you. When I was trying to find some poems today, I had had them send me the couple of sentences that are in your programs of bios, and actually I was like, this is not all they've done. That is not enough. I know that what is buried is much more than so. I found myself looking for poems that I thought would address that, because the one thing that I think for these unsung heroes and the ones of previous years and the ones to come is that sometimes we forget how to be fully human. And that, to me, that's what it is. And it's the memory of that, what it means to be a human, which means that we're doing for others. That's a part. That's where our humanity rests. So I'm really thankful that these people are honored for being both extraordinary and ordinary at the same time, because that's what it takes. It takes for ordinary people to do that little bit extra that makes them extraordinary. And within that, I wanted to remind us all of what's inside of us. Incidentally, within the poem, there's some creation stories because I have a worldview, and so it's from many people's understandings. We hold the great-great-grandparents of our ancestors' grandparents in our bloodstreams, in our stomachs, in our hearts. Thousands of years rest inside our souls. In those records lies the beginning. It is the sweetest marrow in our spine, the cleanest shine in our eyes, the open side of our laughter. You can read it in the lines on the soles of our feet. When we retell the stories of where we came back from, we draw back tree branches to find hidden fruits which we savor, pointed thorns which make us bleed, the yesterdays that lead to here, the heres that lead to tomorrow. When we go back to the beginning, we find the stars. Thousands of years, thousands and thousands of years. In the beginning, there was a time, we all say, when we were not. After that time, we became. We were created. We were molded. We were spat out. We were sung into until we learned how to make, what to form, where to spit, why to sing. But long ago, once, in the beginning, there was only one. And from that one, others were born. And out of those many came us. That is the story we all tell. But before that beginning, before the in the beginning beginning, when we were born, there must have been another beginning. Before the spider crafting web laying 16 eggs, before the mountain birthing lovers, birthing children, before sky settling low to mate with earth, before light, before darkness, before breath, there must have been another beginning. A beginning that lives in that place we call unknowable and yet is braided into the strands of our genealogies. And it is said that it's in that beginning, the beginning before our beginning, it is there that you must go if you want to find the faces of God. Thousands of years, thousands and thousands of years rest inside our souls. And when I thought about the honorees today, one of the things I thought about was these are people who live in yes. There's so many of us that live in no. And it makes a lot of difference to live in yes, and I really think we have to. I really appreciated what the gentleman with the capoeira was saying. I know I live in the Hayes Valley, and you know, I pass the young men on the streets, and a lot of them are slinging drugs or whatever it is they're doing at the moment. You know, a lot of them are just really just standing on the corner because they don't have anywhere to go. So every time you see some young man, don't go, oh yeah, they some dope dealers, because that's just not always it. I say that as the mother of a young man. I got a whole lot of them over at my house all the time. And you know what? I do say hello to them. In the yes, hey, what's up? How you doing? And they quick, if I cross the street, they go, you don't have to cross the street. We're not going to bother you. You know, it's really true, you know. But it's of the yes. And for the four honorees that have been presented thus far and the other ones that will be presented after I speak, all of these individuals, they stay on the yes side of the balance. My life is a scale tipped to yes. Yes to family. Yes to community. Yes to the heavens. Yes to the earth. Yes to the pleasures of flesh and spirit. Yes to life and all its attendant chores and obligations. Yes to struggle. Yes to love. My life is a scale tipped to yes. And I have three little short lists. These lists could go on forever. So these were just what was on my mind at the time. A short list of miracles. The sun rising every day. the ocean and its tides, pearls, silkworms, thousand-year-old redwood trees, lightning, human existence in a universe that is mostly ice, rock, and fire. A short list of tragedies, rape, murder, starvation, oil spills, Agent Orange, anthrax, bullets that shatter people's heads, hearts, backs, limbs, walls, doorways, beds, lives, nuclear waste, bombs. A short list of remedies, food, housing, respect, compassion, education, generosity, empathy, love. Now, I have to say all of my poems, although I didn't bring any romantic love poems or love poems in one way or another. But I just wouldn't be me if I didn't do something that spoke, although the last one did a little bit, to the politic of our time. And I brought this poem specifically because one of the things I also think why the heroes are today are being sung and honored is because they don't have a line between we and them. And I think that that's what we all need to do. And so this poem is called Seeking Unity. In case you wonder who they are, in case you see their shadows on the street, deny the quarters, offer the dollars, turn from the smell, from the glare, from the knife edge of their reality, in case you wonder who they are that stock these blocks, vengeance in hand, snarling as they view the fruit that they have been denied. In case you wonder what flag they wave, what corner they protect, who their mother is, who can be named as father, who is brother or sister, why it is that child. Look in the mirror, it is you. These poor, these violent, these unforgiving, these numbed and soul-forsaken beings, the relentless numbers demanding always that we get, needing always only the things we need, food and clothes, a place to sleep, someone to desire that we flourish, someone to care enough, someone to need us as we need them. If we look for dregs, if we find stardust, it is in their fist, it is in their teardrops, it is in our hearts, it is in our footsteps. They are as human as we let ourselves be. They are as barbaric as we when we turn our backs. Some say only a paycheck away, as if that is a definition of distance. As if they are a reflection only, a broken shard of mirror. But touch your own lips, rub the soles of your feet. Remember that moment when there was no earth to stand on and you had no wings with which to fly. Who guided you? Who caught you in your fall? Who pulled you up, showed you the sunrise? We are only as glorious as they because it is our children who sleep in those doorways, our brothers who cradle those guns, our sisters who barter their bodies, our mothers who lie on those benches of despair. It is our fathers who push those carts full of broken green glass dreams. It is we who are less than human. It is they who are more than alive. Together, we are the forgiving. Apart, we're the desperate. Together we are the attaining. Apart, we're the bitter. Together we are the forgiving. Apart, we are the corrupt. Together we are the sublime. Who are these people who do not have enough? Why do we have to give more and give again? Why do we have to stretch out to them as they reach out to us from our gutters, from our jails, from our hospitals, from our war-ravaged lands, from our doorsteps? Because they are, because we are one. And I would like to end with this one short piece for the stars of today.
I'm constantly looking for the place where science and faith intersect, and so I listen to scientists a lot because they actually tell you if you listen. And so this is, in fact, fact. And this is dedicated particularly to the stars of this afternoon's ceremonies, stardust. Out of clay they caution, dust to dust they intone. From earth you came and to earth you will return, they admonish. They remind us we are mortal and subject to death, yet insist on their eternals, demons and angels, paradise or purgatory, merely human with a finite number of days. But we have exploded as novas, burned through galaxies, explored far reaches of the Milky Way, ridden on the tail of comets, danced on the edge of asteroids until in a dizzying frenzy of passion, we fell through the viscous ozone, past cooling clouds, to settle in the ooze feeding the ocean's floor. It was there that we decided to grow limbs and tongue, all the while holding inside the truth of our origin, magnesium, calcium, iron. We are the stuff that stars are made of. It's a scientific fact. A cosmic truth. In ignorance and in knowing, we hold grains of the divine inside ourselves, and we always have. I thank you so much.
And when I was young, I lived in Tokyo, Japan. My father was in the military, and I was a little bit confused. I went from Tokyo, Japan to Mount Pleasant, Texas. Can you imagine? I was looking for the great America. Everybody asked me if I, when I got to Texas, if I had, when I lived in Japan, did I have any language problems? And I told them that I did. I said, nobody in Texas spoke English. Well, one of the greatest things about it is that once, when I lived in Texas, it was an opportunity for me to be in America for the first time, because when I left America, I was four. And one of the things that I did learn was some words in Japanese. I'm gonna tell this joke, I might get in trouble for it, but I'm gonna tell it anyway, okay. Well, one of the things is that we learned, you know, your phrases, my mom, you know, that sometimes they use kind of colorful language, and I also wanted to have those skills myself. So my mom, I was always losing things. I was a very absent-minded child, and I've stayed in those same footsteps as an adult. I make my kids wear name tags. I don't know who I'm talking to. Well, anyway, I was always losing things, and so my mom would go, Ronnie, what did you do with the comb? Because my mama called me Ronnie, because Veronica is much too long for your mama. What did you do with the comb? And I would say, shit I nai yo mama. Shit I nai yo mama. Shit I nai yo means I don't know in Japanese. So I got away with it. For those of you that are a little bit slow, I'll wait a few more minutes. Okay, that's it for the comedy, folks. And now, for the first time ever, we're gonna present. Hope is gonna come up and present an award for a member of the San Francisco Public Library. For Hope Hayes, and Loretta Dahl's gonna come up, and she's the manager of the Children's Center. So please come on up.
Good afternoon, everybody. Veronica, thank you for that joke. Okay, I had the pleasure this evening to present our first Unsung Hero Award to someone in the library profession. And our recipient is Elizabeth Hope Hayes. She was born and raised in Cairo, Illinois. During her sophomore year at Southern Illinois University in Carbondale, Illinois, she met and married Edmund Hayes, and they moved to San Francisco and raised a son, Byron, and two daughters, Alan and Beverly. Hope reentered college in 1974 and received a BA in English from San Francisco State University in 1977 and an MLS from University of California at Berkeley in 1979. She returned to Southern Illinois that same year and began her career as a librarian. She worked as an academic and public librarian for Southern Illinois University, Carbondale Public Library, Marion Public Library, and the Shawnee Library System. Hope returned to San Francisco and began her career with San Francisco Public Library in 1980 as a librarian one. She worked her way up the career ladder as a supervising librarian, senior librarian, principal librarian, chief of branches, and chief of the main. She was the first African American to hold administrative positions of chief of branches and chief of main. During her reign as chief of branches from 1986 to 1981, she created Neighborhood Libraries Advisory Council, which brought democratic cohesiveness to the neighborhood concerns and recommendations regarding branch library services. Prepared, submitted, and implemented the restructuring of the library services in five neighborhoods, which produced the plans for a new Ocean View branch library. In 1989, she received the State Librarian All-Star Award for tailoring branch library services to respond to the neighborhood needs and for working successfully in partnership and community groups and organizations to accomplish the branch library goals. As chief of the main from 1991 to 1995, her tenure produced outstanding work with staff, community leaders, outside organizations, and special interest groups that produced many successful grants, exhibits, and fundraisers. She was conducive in setting up the fund for donations through the Friends of the Library, for staff events that could not be funded by the city, but were overwhelmingly successful in building staff and morale during tumultuous times of low budgets and major service transitions. She established advisory groups and ad hoc friends groups who have a vested interest in the collections and were willing to assist with fundraising. Hope left the Maine in 1995 to become the director of the newly established African American Museum and Library at Oakland. She retired from that position in 1998. Her remarkable community work continues, and her first passion is continuing education for women, specifically for single parents. In the recent past, she has served as chair of the City of College of San Francisco Southeast Campus Community Advisory Board. During her period as chair, she established the board as a nonprofit organization so that funds could be raised to assist students with book purchases and other scholarships on an as-needed basis. She mentored students and employees constantly, and as chair of the CCSF CalWORKS Education and Training Advisory Board, she mentored welfare-to-work mothers, wrote grants to support the program, as well as solicited and received donations to support the program. She also served on the St. Anthony Foundation Board of Directors and spearheaded their establishment of a women's shelter that provides shelter, rehabilitation, and reentry into the workforce. Currently, Hope does volunteer work for the San Francisco Housing Development Corporation, a nonprofit organization that builds affordable housing in the Bayview Hunters Point and Western Addition neighborhoods. And I also have two anecdotes from colleagues of yours, Hope. One of them is from Matt Smith. A couple of fond memories I have of working with Hope. Hope parking that tired old bookmobile in the well of the old main far enough back so that she could squeeze her small compact in front. She's qualified to valet park for U-Haul, Ryder, Cadillac, and Volkswagen, a real can-do attitude. Her gracious farewell to Mr. Al Campos at his retirement, she acknowledged that as long as she admitted to Mr. Campos that she was nothing but a dumb librarian, she got everything she wanted from the engineer's department. She knew how to work the system, and with passion and dedication to her craft, she accomplished a lot for our organization. God bless you, Hope. You have given much hope to those you have touched. You are truly a hero to me and many others. Matt Smith. And I also sent email to Ed McBride. He wrote, "How appropriate that Elizabeth Hope Hayes is receiving the Unsung Heroes Award. What took you so long to recognize her contributions to the city of San Francisco and to her profession? Whenever I think of SFPL and the time I spent there, the good times always include hope. I will always remember sharing a door between our offices and having that door open on a regular basis to laugh and gossip and just relax. She was always the life of the party, and you could find a light moment in everything." And he recalled two things to make him laugh. "I had just arrived and was very new to California and the ways of San Francisco. Remember, I was raised back home in Alabama, and we did things differently back there. A staff person had a death in her immediate family, and I went next door to ask Elizabeth if she was going to go to the funeral home and if there would be a wake. She looked at me like I had lost my mind and said, 'You are so country boy. This is California, where we do not go to funeral homes or wakes. And before you ask, we don't eat chicken and deviled eggs either. We will go out to dinner and have a nice gourmet meal.' However, when Al Spence passed, she showed me how it was really done when we remembered his life and had a great time in fellowship. I made her promise me she would plan my party when the time comes, even if she is 108. Another memory is of her red garter belt. I am a gentleman and I do not tell the things ladies share with me, but Elizabeth sure looks fine in red garter belts and nylon stockings. She will know what I mean. Please tell her that I am VP of sales at Gale. And if you look real close in your catalog, you will find snake oil for just $49.99 delivered to your door with library processing. There is no finer person that deserves this award. Elizabeth loves her community and has given so much over the years. Without fanfare or now, her character does not allow for a lot of recognition or gratitude. She doesn't need it. The Elizabeth Hope Hayes I know is a hero to many whose lives she has touched and inspired, and I'm honored to consider myself of those people. Love your girlfriend and miss you like a front tooth. Your Southern gentleman friend, Ed McBride," and he's the VP of Gales. So it is with extreme pleasure that I present this unsung hero to my mentor, because I wouldn't be where I am today if Hope had not been here to open doors here at San Francisco Public Library. So I want to present her with this Unsung Hero Award. Hope Hayes.
Thank you very much. Thank all of you for coming out. Thank those who went behind my back, took my biography from my resume, got Loretta Dahl involved, and all of that. I greatly appreciate all that you've done. I also greatly appreciate, and this is a ditto from the awardees who went before me, you're coming out in this weather to see us do and be honored by you. I would like to say that I came to the library service late in life. I did not start out. I had many years of Summer of Love and Marvin Gaye and Heard It Through the Grapevine and Do the Jerk. Be It Whist Where You Slap That Table. A little domino plan, you know, hit the numbers, get it straight. I did much of that before I became serious. And I want to say, in becoming serious and returning to school, I had the support of my family, especially my sister, who was a pinch hit babysitter. I had the support of my son, who could not be here today. He lives in the Midwest. He's a doctor there. And I had the support of there's a young woman who is my god granddaughter. Her grandmother helped me an awful lot with my children. There were times when I thought that I would not be standing before you, which I am. So every day I pray, thank you, God, you've given me another day to get it right, because I'm still stumbling. I want to say that to all of you that one of the things that I found out over the years is that if you give, you receive double. If you support, give a hand up, you receive double. If you smile and make somebody's day, you receive double. And I won't keep you any longer because there are a lot of things that have to go after me. But I want you to know that it's been an interesting trip, this life of mine. I enjoyed every moment at the public library. For my going away gift, the snake oil joke is, I always accused Ed McBride of trying to sell me snake oil because he was constantly trying to get me to use my budget to support his program. He succeeded a lot. But at any rate, upon leaving the library and I left before he did, one of the things he did was gave me a bottle that had snake oil on it. It was actually 90 proof Jack Daniel. But but he had made this wonderful label that said snake oil. So I'm still drinking my snake oil and still doing the best I can to help others because I know that I get it all back in return. And I don't want to embarrass my friends and family, but I certainly would like those who have supported me to please stand up. That includes friends and family, the little boy that helped the gentleman that was reading Langston Hughes. I know you all heard him because I heard him and I said, oh, that's my grandson. Bernice Brown, who helped me through a major illness, please stand. Freda Leeper, who was right there beside her. My friends from Oakland Public Library who helped me get the African American Museum and Library off the ground, Glenda and Marion. And I want to tell you something. While I was doing all of the things I did at the library and going to neighborhood meetings, one of the things I was also doing was spending time with my older granddaughters. And I'm proud to say I have one college graduate and a granddaughter. And one college freshman who comes home every weekend. If you've ever heard the story of laundry, you know, hey, hey. Thank you very much. You've all been very kind.
God bless all the public servants of the San Francisco Public Library and any library, because I tell you, the library card is the best deal in the country. You can get a free card and go around the world. You can master your money issues. You can turn into somebody else and be something else and take a really good vacation cheap. I take them frequently, believe you me. And now we have another wonderful recipient. We have four more recipients to go. I want you guys to give yourself another round of applause because you're still here. And you're looking beautiful. Mrs. Dorris Vincent moved in San Francisco in 1960 and has lived in Bayview Hunters Point almost 99% of the time. Miss Jessie Williams nominated her for the Unsung Heroes Award. Although she's a longtime resident of Bayview, Miss Vincent was diagnosed with stomach cancer in the spring of this year. But while undergoing chemotherapy and radiation, she has not stopped any of the things that she likes to do. She left her illness in God's hand and decided to focus her energy being an advocate for a better quality of life for the residents of Bayview Hunters Point. Did y'all just hear me? She has stomach cancer and she's still working for the behalf of the community. God bless her. She is a major, major contributor to Providence Baptist Church. She was appointed by Mayor Willie Brown to the Hunters Point Shipyard Community Advisory Committee and to Sophie Maxwell to the Municipal Transportation Authority. She has opened her home to individuals and families with no other places to go consistently since she became a homeowner. She has an open house sign right in front of her house. I know because I went there a couple of times. She didn't call the police, but I left right before she did. Her philosophy is that that she remembers growing up in the South where travelers were refused the opportunities to stay in hotel and motels because of segregation. And she woke up in houses with new faces that her mother taken her in. She's a mother of four. She's a grandmother of eight. And she has she's a great grandmother of a brand new baby son. Aww. As anyone can see, Miss Vincent is truly, truly a hero. So wake up, cousins, and put your hands together.
Good afternoon, cousins. I would just like to make one correction. I was diagnosed with a gastric lymphoma, which is a stomach cancer, on October the 21st, 2001. God has been good. I finished my chemo in July 2002. Yeah. And my radiation. Now, whether I still have stomach cancer, I don't know. It hasn't bothered me. My doctors either think it's so far advanced until there's no point in to bother me, or I'm perfectly fine because I've not been able to get a follow-up appointment. I just want to say this to my young people, because I know the rest of us who are Christians know that God orders our steps. And I believe that from the bottom of my heart. I was raised that way. So the first thing you do in the morning is to check in with Him to find out what it is He has for you to do that day. And when you do that, you'll find yourself doing some foolish things, but they work out. And I'll give you an example. My children may have forgotten this, but about 25 years ago, there was a ship out in the bay that was crippled because of a great fire. There was a young man from Ghana that was standing on Market Street, and he looked a little bit distressed, so I asked him if everything was okay. They had been in that situation for a number of days and was stranded. He didn't have any more money and didn't know what he was gonna do. Well, guess what I did? I brought him home. My kids thought I was crazy. It worked out to be perfectly fine. His name was Leland Bile, and I hear from him often. I said that to say this: if the Lord has something for you to do, He will give you that peace of mind to allow you to do it, although it's crazy, and then He will see you through it. The reason I'm in so many meetings is because many times, and I see Reverend McCray, and he can attest to this, many times there's not another African American in the situation to speak for our needs and what we need in our communities. And yet we sit back and say, they did this and they did that. But if there's nobody there to speak for that community. Most of those people don't come into our community, so they have no clue as to what we need. And I just want to thank God for allowing me this privilege to stand before you. And what I've done is just what he ordered me to do. I don't know that it's anything special. He's given to each one of us a charge. And if we ask him what it is, he will lead you and guide you to do it. And I just want to piggyback off of, I want Jessie Williams, maybe you guys don't know her, to stand. I retired in 1996, and Jessie being my churchman, she says, girl, what are you gonna do? And I go, well, I'm gonna be involved with a lot of things. And she says, well, I need a brown bag coordinator for my center. So I've been her coordinator since 1996. I'd like for my children to stand. Just my children. My oldest son is somewhere, I don't see him right now. Then I want my grandchildren to stand. Tanya, you're one of my children, dear. That's my son's wife. I want my grandchildren to stand. I have one granddaughter at Northeastern in Massachusetts working on her master's degree. She finished this university, double major, magna cum laude, department honors. And after having finished, she worked for the Gambian government the first summer out of school. Now I would like for my church family to stand. These are the members of the Providence Baptist Church. And I have a very dear and dear friend that's sitting back in the back. We worked very hard to make her to be the assessor for another 4 years. But you know, we gotta do better. We gotta do better. We want to have people in position, but it takes money. Now, according to me, she's a winner. Stand up, Dorris Ward. If you knew what she did on the budget that she had, it's a miracle. It's a miracle. So had we put the money there, even with all the negative stuff, but like I said to Doris, God has something better for her to do. I know that. Because he does order our steps. And whatever happens, he's in charge. Thank you very much.
What a beautiful woman, right? Put your hands together. That's a beautiful woman. Our next recipient is a very, very special woman. And when she looks at you, it's like the sun coming out and staying out and just radiating on you. And she told me about love. She said, we spoke about love, and I found something that reminded me of her. Grace is love happening, love in action. And I've seen so much grace in the midst of so much brokenness in myself and others that I know we are all in love. We are in love, we are within love, as fishes are in the sea and the clouds in the sky. It surrounds us, it penetrates us and perfuses us. In a very real sense, we are made of love. Can I hear Ashe? Ashe, swimming in a little love. Miss Marcie Byrd, she has a legacy of being rooted and grounded in love through many, many generations. She's the chairperson of a nurture committee And she's also the chairperson of her missionary circle in the wonderful Jones Baptist Church. Methodist Church, I'm sorry. Church, I knew it was one of them. She's assistant to the principal at Jump Academy Carter School. And you know I can't talk now, huh? Charter school cousins. And if you wanna see her face light up, that's all you have to mention one word, Hillary. That is her daughter. Ask her about it when she gets up here. Children are very important to her, and she loves every child that she comes across. She's here to make a difference, and she continues to make a difference. And she believes that love can cure everything, just like I do. So come on up here, Ms. Byrd, and let us honor you as an unsung hero. Don't fall asleep, cousins. Put your hands together.
This day has been too much. I came to California in 1968 with a husband. I'm now single. But along the way, I've gathered a family. And my family consists of the members of Jones Memorial United Methodist Church, who nurtured me and loved me enough to allow me to be who I really wanted to be, and that was a loving person. We are all charged by God to love one another. That's the greatest commandment we have been given. And as I read the papers and I watch the news, now I've stopped doing both, the hope that I have for our future has been diminished by what we are allowing ourselves to do to one another. And so now I find myself, I thought I wanted to have a career where I could earn a certain amount of money, to have a certain status in the community, to own a home or whatever. But I find that my passion is children and to love each and every child that comes across my path. And I know that if I make a difference in one child's life, that's one less chance for someone to take that child's life. Amen. And every day at Jump Charter School, which is housed at Jones and at Providence, I'm given an opportunity to share love with a child. And I like nothing better than to hear them come up the stairs in the morning yelling, "Hi, Miss Byrd, hi, Miss Byrd, hi, Miss Byrd," all day long. And giving me hugs. Because you know, some of these children don't have anyone to tell them they love them. They don't get hugs. And they don't get told how beautiful they are. And so I make it a point of letting them know that I think they're just beautiful. And that all that they have to gain in this life can be gotten through love. And so I thank my Jones family and my daughter, Hillary, yes, is the light of my life. And my daughter, Hillary, if you'll stand. My mentor, my friend, my brother, Reverend James McCray. And all the rest of my family, would you please stand? I thank each and every one of you for loving me as you do with all my faults. Reverend McCray, years ago I used to sing, and he had me sing a song, "He's Preparing Me for Something I Can't Handle Right Now." Well, I'm handling it now, Reverend, because our future in this city, as our numbers decline, our future depends on everyone raising up a child to be strong and healthy and loving. Thank you.
And I would now I'd like to introduce Mr. Curtis Jones with a quote. Yeah, go ahead and shout, Mr. Jones. With a quote by Nelson Mandela. Nelson Mandela said that we were born to make manifest the glory of God that was in us. It's not in some of us, it's in every one of us. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our fears, our presence automatically liberates us. Mr. Jones is a leader who believes in leading by example. He believes that I am not a celebrity, but the path I've taken produces the opportunity where, when one needs help, you can also help yourself. As a result of a near-fatal automobile accident, Mr. Jones had a spiritual awakening through sobriety, through AA. Y'all can clap for that. Because sobriety is wonderful. And he was inspired to co-found Liberation House. Does that keep you from working at a job? Because I need to go to a Liberation House if that's the truth. Okay, you guys, no more jokes, okay? Liberation House, says Mr. Jones, was founded and designed to be a place where gentlemen can sit and think about their lives, about reversing the patterns of jails and institutions and irresponsibility. What I said was that about reversing the patterns of jail and institution and irresponsibility. God bless you, Mr. Jones. Come on up and accept your award.
Thank you. I must say, this is a lovely day. First, I would like to say I would like to give my church's name and my pastor's name, River of Life Church of God in Christ. My pastor is Reverend Robert Cowan. In my long journey of sobriety, and you know, this is something that I guess we don't get a chance to talk about too much, and this is where maybe it starts, and this is where we have to start and get back to where we should be. And this is what I've been working so hard for. And I would like to say that God saved me way back there. When? I'm so glad that he did save me. And I can remember when I was down and out, when I found myself out overnight and $7,000 in debt in the year of 1973. I can remember that I had told so many lies to God. If you just let me get through this time, I promise you I'll never do it again. And that's one time that I didn't let him down. Say, if you do it this time, I'm just not gonna do it anymore. So that is where we go back to. And I have to give you a little background on what's happening here. We go back to 1973, and that's been 29 years ago. And I met a man, Dr. Hannibal Williams, in case any of you know him. He was my pastor for 19 years. He passed away the first in January of this year. And he had a dream then. He and I got together with some other people, and this is what we came up with, Liberation House. It's a program for people who's recovering. I myself have seen 11,000 people go through that program. And I think that's a lot of people that go through a program. I see the need, and I see where all our men have gone. I see them every day. The ones that I see, they need help. I do as much as I can to help them. I think we can go further. And I would like to go further into trying to help them. This is what my goals are, is to go, because that was my promise, that I would always, some people ask me, well, why do you work so hard? Why do you keep doing this? Well, I don't want to do it, but I have to do it, because that's my commitment. It's first to God and to everyone else, my family. And I have a wonderful family now. As I can see, I did not have that back there then. And I, you know, some people are kind of hesitant about, well, what, you think this guy stayed sober? Has he been sober that long or whatever? And I say, and I have to keep it in my mind, well, I don't care maybe what you think about me or what I look like, but thank God I ain't what I used to be. And you have to. So I try to keep an open mind to that. I thank God that He has given me, whenever I feel that there's a need for something or I should do something, I don't have to have a whole lot of education through school. He blessed me enough that I can do something here with what I'm doing. And what I did do is I wrote a book, and it was sort of like a autobiography, and it gives a background of the whole thing. And for anybody who has a problem, whether it be drugs or whether it be overeating, whether it be anything, would probably help them. I would just kind of like to show you this. I don't know if I have permission to show this, but I'm going to show it so you can see it. And when you see this little book here, you might want to read it from the library, or maybe they might get one or something like that for you. When I did do this, I wasn't looking to make any money from it, and I have not made any. The people who sponsored, the financial people who sponsored me, when I told them about the idea, I had shopped it around, and I told them about the idea, and they said they would think about it. They're from New York. And they called me one day and said, you know, I looked at the draft of your book here, and we kind of think that we might have it published. We'll give you the finance to have it published. So they did do that, and they published. So the book is here. It's out. And I thank God for that, because I told them then, I don't have a quarter to pay you back, and I don't know how you'll ever get your money. And they said, well, for the work that you're doing, you deserve it. So that's the way that went. And getting back to the program, a lot of fellas come into the program and they don't really know what to call me. And I said, well, what do you want me to call you? I said, well, you can call me what you want to call me. So some call me Dr. Jones, some call me, well, that man. And some called me that fella, and I said, that's okay, that's fine with me, it's okay. I have no problem with that. But I think that as a whole, and the public could get more information on what we're trying to do and what we're doing, and accomplishing that we're making over there, I think that would be a great big help to us, and it'd be a build up for us to keep us going. And I do have some people in the house here, some very good folks that I would like to introduce a little bit later here. I guess we could do it now, especially my good friend Freddie, who's worked so close with me. If I could just have some of the people from the program stand up, or who's in recovery and pass, would you just stand up? Thank you. And last but not least, I'd like for my wife and my daughter to stand up. And this has really been a long road for me, and we just look like we're just getting started, and we're just denting things. But I see the young men that come into the program, the older men that come into the program. And I always have to tell them, look, I did travel that road, so you don't have to be ashamed of anything. Just Get yourself together, and the sky's the limit. You can do anything that you want to do. And this is a spirit that we have to do with these young men. We just need something, just a little bit more things going for them. So many of them get involved with the jails, and I think we try to do something about that a little bit later, try to figure something else to help them out with that. These are just some ideas that's coming into my head, and I just hope that God give me permission what he want me to do with that. And we can probably get some help there, and we can do a wonderful job. I think it's just too many. We're losing too many people, and it hurts my heart to see so many people being lost just over nothing. It's just simply over nothing. There's no reason for it. And so somebody has to re-educate them, and you know, I just say, why not me? So why not everybody else? Why can't everybody else do something? So anybody that can do a little bit help. Anybody can do some help. And whatever you do, as the lady said earlier, you can smile at somebody, you can say something, you can say hello, and whatever is going on. And I always tell the people, well, when you come into the program, remember where you were, but when you were on the streets and then you come in here and you get on the bus, you get a smile and people don't mind you sitting down beside of them. You know, these are improvements here. These are the small things that you have to live with from day to day. So I thank God for the time that he has given me in my sobriety. And I have really enjoyed it, and so many good things has happened to me. And I just like to share this with you that we're not lost, and it's hope there. I reached my bottom at 42 years old. I got married at 48. My first son came at 50. My daughter came at 55. So I think God has really been blessing me in the area there. So this is the work that we are trying to do in the community, and we're going to study and keep on trying to do that. So I need your prayers. I need all of you to pray for us, because it's a hard job, and it's really worthwhile. So I would just like to say, as my favorite person said, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you so much for all you do. Thank you so much. It's amazing. You know, I was reading something from Dr. Gerald May, and he says, we seldom realize our preciousness. We're so busy and we're so occupied with so many little things that we're blind to the one great thing. Only in the pause between things, in a brief contemplative space of just being, can we catch a glimpse of love itself. And speaking of love itself, let's talk about Miss Barbara Thompson. Speaking of love itself, I'm talking about you, Ms. Thompson. Ms. Thompson is a health educator and community relations expert, as well as a fierce advocate who has worked tirelessly to enhance the quality of life for residents throughout the entire city of San Francisco. Ms. Thompson is a retired Kaiser Permanente employee, where she was the director of the Health Education Library. That, my favorite word, library, comes up again. She was the principal organizer of the program where she set policies, purchased materials, and established operational procedures. Ms. Thompson has been an activist in the OMI community for many years, and we are privileged and excited to make you an unsung hero today. So come on down, Ms. Thompson, it's your turn.
I want to first thank Agnes Morton, who nominated me, and hi. I just want to thank everybody that I've been able to help, but I think I've been able to help them because there's a little man sits on my shoulder. It's called God. And every time I go to do something, I notice he pops up. I don't know why, because there have been times when I couldn't do anything, and he still pops up. But there's something that someone told me a long time ago, and that was, he never asks you to carry a cross unless you can. If you can't carry it alone, ask for help. His own child asked for help. I thank all of you for coming today. I know all of you didn't come to see me, but thank you anyway. God bless all of you. I'm not gonna talk a lot.
And one of the prime examples of a wonderful, talented, smart young man who is a leader. Jonathan, come back on up, please, and sing us one more song. Thank you, cousin.
Let me see which mic works better. This song is the contrary to what could happen if people didn't care in the community, if people didn't give their love and share with their families and just extend a hand to the community and love one another and help themselves and, you know, build themselves. It's by Michelle Farrell. It's called Peace on Earth. How can we have peace in the Middle East when there's none at home? And how can we have understanding in the land when there's none in a woman, when there's none in a man? How can we heal the wounds of the world if we cannot heal our own? And where is this peace on earth begin if not at home? Now where do we go now? Do we let the devil in, or do we get up and fight? Surely we know how to conquer our fears, give an end to the violence, bring an end to the tears. How can we heal the wounds of the world if we cannot heal our very own? And where is this peace on earth begin if not in the home? Well, it's too much talk about it, and too many walk without it. Now tell me, where is the love? And where is the God in your life? To my left, somebody's abusing their children. To my right, somebody's beating their wife. Tell me, where is the love? And where is the God in your life? How can we heal the wounds of the world if we cannot heal our very own? And where is this peace if not at home?
Hey, Jonathan. Wow.
That was beautiful. Thank you.
Wow.
Step aside. Well, we've come to the end of our program, and I'm so happy to see all of you still here. That's wonderful. It's been a wonderful day, a wonderful program, and you're going to eat very well very soon. But before we go, I would like to thank some people who've been instrumental in putting this program together. And first, I would like to thank our MC, Veronica Dangerfield, for doing a wonderful job. That's for you. I'd also like to thank our keynote speaker, devorah Major. Thank you so much for coming out. I'll give that to her. That's for you. I would like you to acknowledge Marcia Snyder, who is our Director of Public Affairs here at the library, who came out. Thank you, Marcia. And I would like, for those people who are part of our planning committee, I'm just going to name off your names. If we just wave to us, that would be fine. Stewart Shaw from the African American Center. Is Ms. Pavis back there? Ms. Pavis? She just went that way. Ms. Pavis, who was giving out the programs and making you sign in as part of our planning committee. Also Hazel King, which I think she did have to go. She was part of the committee as well. Chinetta Jackson, another librarian in the back, who's a librarian in the newspaper and periodical room. Thank you, Chinetta. And Joan Jackson, who's sitting way in the back there, who actually started this program 14 years ago at the Western Edition branch. She's retired now, but she has been supportive for the program through her retirement. So thank you, Joan. I would also like to take a moment. Usually this program is videotaped by a gentleman named David Schwabe. He's the manager of media services. And he's done this for 14 years. Unfortunately, he lost his wife this past week, so I would like us to all say a prayer for him and his family, who's going through quite a bit right now. But I would also like to thank Joan Lefkowitz for taking over and doing a wonderful job back there on the video and the audio and her staff here. And last but not least, I'd like to thank the women of the National Council of Negro Women, who are going to be serving you a wonderful meal as we close. So. Thank you all for being a wonderful audience, and see you in the reception room, the Latino-Hispanic room, right in the after the foyer into the library there. Okay? Thank you.